all for you. Yeah, yo. There whenever it matters, and even more when you feel like it doesn't. Protect you so you never feel like you wasn't. Know I'm right alongside you, here by that or I'm behind you, but always got you, end of discussion. Nothing means more, first one to offer his shoulders for what you reach for. Thought I saw the eyes of the world until I seen yours. And know that I ain't see a better view yet. I'm with whatever, so don't ever you fret. Know that you covered, not a hurdle or a heartbreak. A change would a partake, cause none of them won't ever get comfortable in your walkway. My job is to aware you, fully loaded to prepare you for all of the above that I'm never letting get near you. But still in all, give you every advantage I found. Couldn't find a better fit for them along with my crown. And since the baton was passed, I've been down, cause failing's not an option and dad is not a noun, not at all.
What's going on, everybody? This is Ishmael. What you just heard was the rendition by this artist that I have on right now, Ozma Jam of the D'Angelo. Awesome. She's an awesome, just phenomenal artist. She sings, she writes her own music. She's a beat maker. She's just everything, man. She's pretty awesome, and I'm glad to have her on the show. Ozma Jam, how you doing?
I'm really good. How are you doing?
I'm great. Quick question. Why Ozma Jam? Tell me the story behind the name.
I would say it's kind of an accident. I
Okay.
was brainstorming with a friend really a long time ago, because I've been going by that name for many, many years, more than 10 years, in fact. And we were just discussing, and I wanted to have, kind of a pun with a jam session and osmosis, and so we came up with his name.
And it's a great name because it fits your personality as an artist, because you're like the type of person that likes to just sing anytime or just jam anywhere. Tell me an experience where, you were anywhere and you just started to sing. Did you like let's say let me give you an idea. Remember the Tyrese commercial when he was sitting on the bus listening to the music to record with
Sweet
someone?
lady.
Have you ever had a moment like that where you were like maybe on a bus or a train and you just start singing?
Yes, it happened. It happened, but I would say a really long time ago, because I have the impression that with time, I'm kind of becoming more and more of an introvert, So that's funny, because we were talking about jam sessions, and currently I'm not doing any shows, and I'm focusing a lot about creating music, doing some beat making, composing, and I'm really not exchanging live with people. I feel I need to, for the time being, I'm cool being alone, being in my bubble, and trying to come up with something different. So yes, I would say I used to sing a lot with my friends. I used to be in a choir. I did a lot of backing vocals for French artists also. One or two times I went for TV shows and so on, for the backing vocals. But yeah, I would say, yeah, it's really been a while since I've jammed somewhere. I used to do it, but I don't do it anymore, because I think it's not everywhere, but sometimes I felt in jam sessions in certain places in Paris that there was too much of a competition, too much of bragging about the way you do these runs, and you do this, and you chew these notes, and it's awesome, and so on. And I'm really not into that kind of stuff. So yeah,
Yeah,
I'm not disappointed by my answer.
no, that was perfect. It was on the point. And you talked about how, you love being an introvert. Do you think the pandemic caused that too? Because we were locked down for a year. So my next question to you is, what has the pandemic taught you?
Quite a lot. I would say the first thing is that I'm really lucky and privileged, because I'm comfortable. I have a roof over my head. I can eat whatever I want. I have a stable job, because I have a day job. I have a 9 to 5, and so seeing all these impoverishment, seeing all this misery, I would say it was it's really a problem, and it's really sad, but we get used to that kind of stuff. And at the beginning of the pandemic, and at the beginning of the lockdown, you couldn't look away, it was right in front of your eyes. So yes, it made me appreciate what I have. I had travels planned. I'm from Martinique, so it's an island in the French West Indies. So I wanted to go there. I could not, but instead I took this habit to wander in the park just a few blocks away, and I realized that's enough. So I would say that's the main stuff. Then as I said earlier, I'm a loner. I'm kind of an introvert. Right. And I realized I did not really suffer from the lockdown, from the impossibility to go out. Right. It did not, I would say, yeah, it showed me that it was okay to be a loner and it could be a strength.
Right.
I've always experienced a lot of self-doubt. I always ask myself a lot of questions. I would say with the pandemic and the lockdown, it made me, you know, organize all these questions and you know, ask clearer question. Right. I questioned uncertainty a lot. You know, recently I heard a podcast and they featured part of a conversation with a French philosopher who's called Charles Pépin. Right. And he was explaining that all our education and all the day-to-day activities and so on, and we are not prepared and we are not educated to deal with uncertainty. Everything we do is just as if, you know, you have to be good at school, you have to have a great job, you have to make money, you have to have a family, you have to be a father or a mother. And it's just like, you know, the path is there and you know, you just have to do it and that's it. And we don't think about unforeseeable events. We don't think about black swans.
Yeah,
because the pandemic is a black swan. I don't know if you know that expression.
Yes.
So it made me realize that maybe it's okay to have doubts, not to be certain, to have sometimes difficulties to make decisions because nobody knows nothing.
No. You're absolutely right. And just talking about that, because, you know, I'm a big advocate on mental health, right? Yeah. You know, I'm honest about my story. You know, I almost committed suicide 2 years ago because I was in a black place. But going to mental health, was there a point in the pandemic or just music wise that kind of put you in a mental health challenge? Like you was talking about, like the self-doubt and things like that. Can you kind of like elaborate like that? Because some people can handle that well than other people. I know me personally, like I said, when I was in my black dark place, it led me to that point where, you know, I almost did that. And, you know, I still suffer from depression. So my journey personally is that I have to continually affirm myself. Because if I don't affirm or give myself affirmation, I'll put myself in that place. But if you want to elaborate on like your mental health challenges.
I think I've always... I'm kind of a melancholic person, so I think I've always had some periods where, you know, I think I'm not good at anything. I think what I do does not matter. I'm not sure the pandemic really changed the way I function. Because I was kind of forced to be clearer, as I said, with all the questions.
Right.
In a way, it was kind of reassuring, you know. Right. So I don't know if I'm clear, but
yeah, you are. You definitely are.
Yeah, and we had more time in a way. This can be discussed also, but because, you know, so I was working from a distance. I was not in the offices, and I know many of my coworkers suffered from not being able to exchange in person. They were like kind of addicted to their phones, the mails, and so on. I was not affected by that because, as I told you, I was kind of reassured that I could deal with it. I could deal with being alone. I could deal with the silence. But I would say, coming back to mental health, maybe it made me, you know, pay more attention to that kind of stuff, because I saw many posts, many Instagram posts about mental health at that time, and specifically within non-white communities. Because, you know, we have a problem with mental health as black people.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know if I answered your question.
No, but, you definitely did.
Maybe I was less self-conscious about it. It made me less self-conscious about it. I usually don't speak, I would say, publicly about that kind of stuff.
Right.
But yes, it made me think about how I want to spend my energy. Maybe it's not worth it, you know, arguing with coworkers or people about stuff that won't matter as time passes by. So, yeah.
No, that's perfect. But also, through the pandemic, you've released a lot of music. Just talk about, like, that. I see that was your kind of your therapy, being an introvert, being by yourself. You were able to make music, make beats, do a lot of renditions. So just talk about that musical journey for yourself through the pandemic.
As we got more time, and as I, you know, I procrastinate a lot, it was easier, for instance, to go and try learning the guitar, for instance, because I've been wanting to do it for a long time. So I'm still not playing very, very, very good. I'm okay, but
you're better than me.
I need to practice. You know, with the social medias and all that stuff, I think people forget how much time you need to put in the practice. You won't have rewards immediately, and yes, having more time, I found it easier to finally buy a guitar and say, okay, I'm level zero, but that's okay, it will take time, that's okay. I did not really release original material. What I did was I said, okay, I need to have more skills, to enhance my skills in beat making, in composing. And so what I did, I took songs I enjoyed and I tried, you know, to pick up the chords and study how they did this and that, how they did the beat, how they sang. And at the end, I said, okay, let's value this and put this on social media. But the main driver, I think, should not be having some content to put on social media. I think when you have this in mind, that's not good. You know, that kind of perverts your work ethics. And it's really difficult because as an underground artist, you don't have many channels, you don't have many ways, you know, to make your artistry known. So you're kind of forced to feed the machine.
Yeah.
But and maybe during the pandemic, I kind of lost myself with that, putting a lot of energy doing covers and so on. And right now I'm kind of, you know, cover songs are okay, but people are, you know, sometimes it's frustrating because all people want is you to cover other artists. And so there's no place anymore for what you have to bring on the table. So yes, I'm trying to not do too many covers and really preserve my energy to put it in original songs and original composition.
And I think that's what you have with the recent project. You know, like I've seen a lot of stuff that you put on social media with the synthesizer, like with the beats, like the recent project, the like using the Caribbean sound.
Yeah.
Talk about that influence of that Caribbean sound to your to the sound that you created.
Yeah, sure. So let me tell you how I came up with that project idea. I listened to a lot of podcasts and I came across a very interesting one, which translates hybrid music, I would say. Okay. Hybrid music. And the host focuses, each episode, she focuses on forgotten traditional music genre from the Caribbean. Right. And her aim is to, challenge the vision of the Caribbean as of Caribbean music as, you know, summer music, with people always talking about, you know, parties, sex and all that kind of stuff. Right. And listen to her, I realized I did not know anything about traditional music from Martinique, from the island of my mother.
Right.
And I was kind of, you know, it was kind of a shame for me. Wow. And I realized that I really overlooked this legacy for too long. And so I said to myself, okay, it would be a good exercise to try and sample these songs. So I began with the begin style. I did the zouk style. I don't know if it sounds familiar or not. Huh?
No, it does. That's why I'm shaking. I'm like bobbing my head.
Oh, okay. and yes, and the aim was to reconnect with that legacy, doing a, I would say, simple exercise,
right,
trying to blend it with hip hop. Trap music is really interesting in the way that it blends with nearly everything.
Right.
And you know, I saw it doing the project.
Right.
And when I posted it, I saw that it was, people were both surprised and they were happy to see the culture put forward like this. Right. And so when I did four or five, I don't remember, and I said, okay, it's at the beginning I did that for Instagram, but you know, Instagram does not deserve this. I need to, because you have some constraints also, because I know we all crave attention and it's really rare. So I put a lot of constraints on myself, doing only 30 seconds beat and so on. And I said, no, I need to, you know, I need to value what I did. And so that's why I took all the creation, all the little beats I had made. I made them a bit longer, and I said, okay, this will be a project, and you know, it's kind of a testimony of the journey I'm beginning, because the culture is very rich, and I'm just at the beginning. I still know nothing, I would say.
I would say from the sound, I think you're in the right direction, and I love how you brought it back to your mom and the roots and legacy and finding your legacy. Cause I think that's the one thing about the journey. Your journey has to begin from somewhere, right?
Mm.
We came from somewhere, and to realize that, you know, to bring that Caribbean sound abroad, even though it exists, but to bring it, create it as your own, to learn about your past, but more importantly, to show people, yes, I am a woman of color and I did that.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the empowerment of that. Like when people see your face, like, oh, you did that? And you're like, yeah, I did that. Like, talk about that.
You know, I'm not sure people really realized I'm doing it.
Really?
I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm not sure because, as I said, nowadays you have to be really clear about who you are. About who you are, just in 15 seconds, you need to make to convey your message, and you don't have much room for subtlety. And I'm not sure everybody understands what I'm doing. I have an anecdote. I was at a book club. And I was talking about the host, with the host, sorry. And she was introducing me to to other people. And she said, yes, she's an artist. She's doing remix. And she wasn't sure, you know, she wasn't sure because I don't have, you know, I have, she wasn't sure. She could just say, oh, she's a singer. Oh, she's a producer. She did not really know. So yeah, that was kind of an indication that it's really complicated to not to be in a single practice. So so that's why I'm not sure everybody really understands what I'm doing. I hope so, but I'm not sure. Also, something that bothers me a little bit is that I have in my following a majority of men, and I think it's because they are really into you know, beat making and all that technical stuff about using synthesizers and so on. And yeah, it's a shame because it really bothers me not to be able to resonate with other women of color, but other women in general, but other women of color. So I hope in the next months, weeks, I will be able to reach out to more women. And about what you said about my mom and the roots and so on, I have we talked about Afrobeat and Afropop earlier. The Zouk rhythm.
Yes.
It's you know, Justin Bieber is using it. I don't even know if he knows it. Huh, you know, everybody is using it. We have also a big star in France, Aya Nakamura. I don't know if you know her. No. And now journalists are presenting her as, you know, she does Zouk. It's the new generation and so on. And I'm like, yeah, but you know, it's not only, Zouk is really important in our culture. It was a very important movement to give some pride back to people from Martinique and Guadeloupe, to value the language also, Creole.
Right.
And so, yes, it's kind of frustrating to see, I will use the big word, this kind of cultural appropriation.
Cultural appropriation, that's perfect, yes.
While us, so we don't really, it's not possible. You know, it's not possible for me to see that happening and not to know about my story, not to know about this this culture, this complex and genius rhythm, I would say. Right. And so, yes, that's why it's really important. And I'm just at the beginning, as I told you.
No, and I totally agree with you, because when I try to explain people about country music, I tell people country music is not white people music.
Mm.
Country music derives from Africa. The banjo is an African instrument. And I think that's the most important thing, is that as we do our research, we have to learn that the sound is important, but it's important to realize where the sound come from.
That's true, yeah.
Because that sound has a story.
Mm.
And that sound created from like people like us. You see? Not that.
Yeah.
and in fact, and I love what you're doing. And my ultimate goal is, you know, I want to show these to little girls of color with beautiful hair like yours, that you can sing, you can make beats, you can produce music. It's possible. because I'm talking to the person right here that's doing that. And I think that's important. And like I said, it's important that we have representation. It's important we have affirmation. But the most important thing is that we have to do it. And that's the one thing I get frustrated in music or even just in movies, is that we wait for other people to create it for us. Mm. And not knowing there's people out there that are creating it. We just have to support it. And that's the one important thing that I'm trying to do with this platform, is just put it out there. If one little girl sees you today on this show and gets inspired and then make it and then win a Grammy, and you say, you know what? The reason why I was inspired, because I was inspired from an episode of That Is Not Now when you talked to this young lady, Ozma Jam, and she did all these great stuff that a lot of people didn't know she did. I watched it and it inspired me to do what she did. And I'm a part of her legacy. So like, just talk about that too. Even though, you know, you're underground, a lot of people don't know your music, but when they see you, and then that impact, talk about that impact and legacy. Like, you talked about the legacy with your mom and Caribbean, but talk about you, where you're at, and for like little girls that look like you and the inspiration you bring to them, knowing that you're doing all these things. I know I'm throwing you all this at the same time, but I want to just let you know that, you know, what this pandemic has taught me is that while people are alive, you got to give them their flowers where they're alive, or when they're sick, give them their soup. And that's where I'm at. And I've been following your career for the longest time. And it's important that we recognize, you know, people like yourself that's doing it, even though you're not getting, you know, the shine or whatever. But I want to just recognize you for what you're doing. So if you want to touch on that for a little bit, don't get emotional on me, please.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for your kind words. It really means a lot. You know, I just want to go back to what you're saying about, you know, little girls seeing, maybe coming across what I do. And I think we really need, and the pandemic showed this to us also, I think we really need to question the way we see success, the criteria we apply to say, okay, this person is successful, this person matters, and this person does not. And it's funny because I've been thinking a lot about what it is to be an underground artist today. And I was not sure that I still was an underground artist, because when you look at the definition, it's quite difficult to have a really accurate definition, because it's the underground defines against the mainstream, and as the mainstream is always moving, it's difficult to have a clear definition. But I asked myself this question because with, you know, the spread of all the tools to record, to compose and all that stuff, today everybody can claim to be an artist. And I'm not, for me, it's not a bad thing. For me, it's not a bad thing, but we have to recognize that because of the abundance of music, of creation, of lyrics, of everything, for the audience, I mean, people who are not completely aware of what it takes, of the work it takes, to, you know, to master an instrument, to listen to a lot of music, to know where you're coming from, but to know what has been done before you, because we didn't invent anything. With all that bearing in mind all of that, I think that for me right now, it's not a problem not to have shine or not to be recognized and all that stuff. What matters is to bring something different on the table, even if two people see it, you know? And so I would just add a little something additional to that little girl, is that even if you don't have a Grammy, you're successful. You're successful because if you dedicate yourself to a practice, a musical practice, at the end of the day, you created something, even if you don't share it, it has values. it is valuable, sorry. So yes, I would just add that because I think we this message of this the artist now being an entrepreneur and now doing business, I don't like it at all. I think it's it does not work. I think it does not work, and I think to put something new to the table, to put something moving out there. It's really difficult if you are obliged, you know, as I said, to feed in Instagram or Google, and I don't know, and to have money from brands and so on. And that's why maybe what really changed during this pandemic is I'm not ashamed anymore to have a day job and to have a 9-to-5. It's freedom because I don't need to worry about how many people will listen to what I do. I don't need that. At the end of the day, it does not change my, you know, my comfort. It does not change the way I live. And so it's freedom in a way. So yes, I need I have blocks of times where my brain is doing things for a firm. Right. But when I'm not working, I have complete freedom in music. So yes, it's important to have alternative path and to challenge the way we define success and the way we define what matters.
And I think that's important too, because I don't want to put pressure on you. I know we talked about it earlier, but I see you as similar as the legend of Henry Salvador. The reason why, because you're an artist that sings French beautiful. You sing English beautiful. And not a lot of artists are, I wouldn't say successful, but are great when it comes to singing in different languages, you know? And I just want to let you know that, you know, and Henry Salvador is one of my favorite artists of all time, even though I don't know a lot of French, but I do listen to a lot of his songs in French, because that's how I try to learn language. Let's do music. And also listening to you, your French music too, that kind of gives me, you know, to learn a different language. But yeah, I just wanted to let you know about that, because when I hear you sing, I think of Henry Salvador, of an impact that you made on my life just hearing.
Well, like, that's an honor. Music. I'm really honored.
Just hearing new music and just hearing originality and just hearing that you care. Because you know, as an artist, you're an artist, when you listen to someone sing, you can hear that they care to someone that's just looking at it as just a job.
Hmm. Thanks a lot. Thanks. I'm honored to be compared to Henry Salvador. And you know, that's funny because one of the pioneers of Begin, the Begin genre, and Ernest Léardé, he worked with the Salvador brothers. I think he worked with Henry's brother. Wow. Yeah, he made a record with him, I think. Yeah. So yes, about French, English, and Creole. We did not.
Yes.
About Creole, my but bad. I just No worries. I'm mentioning it. Sorry, because I just released with a very talented beatmaker. His name is Ayazis. I released the track where it's the first time I sing in Creole. And about those languages, I would say it's kind of it's a very complex question, because the French soul R&B movement, it's not coming from our roots. It's just us, you know, appreciating what the Afro-American community created and trying to put our own twist in it. But yeah, you are the trailblazer we are following. I'm not ashamed to say it. It's the truth. But when I did my first LP, my first try, so Escape, Échappé in French, I think, thinking about it right now, I did not realize I needed to put much more work writing lyrics in French, because, you know, my approach at that time was just, oh, okay, I will do a track like SWV, for instance, and right. No matter what I sing in French, it's okay, as long as, you know, it's not too, there are not too many R's right. in French, or really, you know, tough sounds, it's okay. And listening to it after a few years, there was some kind of, you know, it was not balanced. It was I felt it was not, there was something not finished in it. And so after that, I switched to English completely. But recently I realized if I wanted to speak my truth, I need to do it with my own language. So I have a few tracks coming in a few singles in English. But I think it's really important that I do not dodge the difficulty to write in French and to write in French with that kind of genre. It's really complicated. It's really complicated in French not to be cheesy, because, you know, this culture comes from the hood. So you cannot just, you know, write a poem right. that sound very very bougie.
It does not work at all
right. And I think I was a bit reluctant to do that work beforehand. So right now I'm in it. So I'm trying to write in French, but it takes me a lot of time, I write and rewrite, and it takes a lot of time, and I hope I'm onto something. And yes, I did this track in Creole, but it's kind of a challenge also, because, you know, that's a language where it does not suffer any accent. Right. You know, you see my accent there in French. It's right. I really hate it. I have no accent in English when I talk, but, you know, right. I cannot help it. But in Creole, it's even worse. You cannot. When you have an accent, it does not work. So it's really challenging. The beatmaker I'm working with is from Guadeloupe, so the sister island, and so he's helping me a lot. And actually, the Creole is it's not really. The track I'm talking about is Kévancé, so I will go on.
Right,
that's what it means. And in fact, it's not really Creole from Martinique, it's Creole from his island. Okay. So yeah, progress to be done there.
I'm excited about the project, and I wish I could talk with you for like hours, you know, but I know we have other jobs we have to get to. I don't want to put you on the spot. You can do it if you want to. If you want to do it, go for it. If not, I understand.
You want me to sing?
If you want to, and in Creole, if you want to, you know, give us a taste of what you're working on, and then also the product that you have done, is that link available? Because if it is, I'll put it in the description so people can listen to it.
Okay, so the link for Caribbean Minute, it's the project, the only instrumental tracks. I will send it to you. It's available, and I can sing to you the first part of the first verse of Kévancé. So as you can see how it sounds in Creole, it goes like Kikou les yeoye en bas soleil chaud la qu'à songer. Si on joue moins qu'est est ouvert, mais c'est mon lap. Sorry.
Okay, that's all right. I love it.
You got my words.
You got everything going on. You're thinking about, all right, what am I going to eat for lunch? I got to go grocery shopping. Sunday, yeah. I got to do laundry. So you got all this on his head, and he's like, I got this dude that I never met asking me to sing Creole. Like, what the fuck?
No, but it's okay. It's okay. No, but, you know, I'm not self-conscious, because people need to see nothing is perfect. You know, right now I'm not wearing makeup. I'm wearing my glasses. It's okay. It's not. We are not perfect. So yes, I forgot my words. But sorry.
No, that's okay. That's okay. Do you want to start over again, or you want?
No, it's okay. I'd rather you listen to the track where's no error and no you know hesitation and so on.
Ozma Jam, this was an amazing conversation. Thank you so much. You are a wonderful human being. Just the complete package. Anytime you want to come on to promote what you got going on, let me know, whether if it's in French, whether it's English, whether it's Creole, this platform is open for you. So before we end, how can people find you?
So I'm on Instagram. It's we are all forced to be on Instagram, I would say.
Yes,
so yeah. At Ozma Jam. I have a YouTube channel, and if people want to communicate with me in a little more intimate way, I have a newsletter, and if people want to mail me, it's okay. And they are welcome. It's okay. They are really warmly welcome. And that's about it.
And we're out. Thank you again, Ozma Jam. Make sure you support her, you know, all the music, follow her YouTube page, follow on IG. Check out the Afro beat that she got going on. This girl is just doing everything, man. She's an amazing person. And I finally got a chance to get to know her a little bit. And we're out. Peace.